Thanks very much. First, I'd like to thank the organizers for the invitation to speak here. It's really a pleasure to be back in Berkeley. So what I'd like to talk about is based on a project with John Martin and Vivek Shende, so every result I'll describe is joint with them. And it's based on joint work that's, we're partway through. So phase one of the project is on the archive. And what I'll talk about mostly is phase 1.5 today, and I'll indicate where it fits into the sort of general scheme of our plan. So maybe let me just recall some motivation for legal sectors and why we need such a notion, whatever such a notion is. So we start with an exact symplectic manifold, which is Euville, okay. Meaning it's modeled at infinity on the symplectization of a contact manifold, where lambda gives the contact form for this contact manifold, which I'll call the boundary of infinity of x. And by model at infinity, I mean this modeling is compatible somehow with the Liouville vector field, which is the symplectic dual of lambda. In particular, Z, the Liouville vector field, which is the symplectic dual of your fixed primitive of the symplectic form, is expanding in this region. So we start with the Liouville manifold. Whenever we have such a gadget, we can consider the core or the spine of this manifold. Okay, so this is the locus not flowing to infinity via z, so the locus that's stuck as you flow positively by z, and this is some sort of, you know, subset of your manifold. At the moment, we have no assumptions on dimension yet, but we will very quickly make some assumptions. So there's a conjecture that we're aiming to address that studies the Foucault category of such a manifold under some hypotheses in terms of its core spine. So I'll draw a picture in a minute. But let me just state the conjecture first. So this conjecture, due to Konsevich in roughly 2008, says that under certain hypotheses, x, such as Weinstein, so x emits a Weinstein structure, meaning up to some deformation of one forms, so this Liouville vector field is gradient-like for a Morse function. I won't write it down, but I'll just say that the consequence we'll care about in this talk is that the spine is a possibly singular Lagrangian subset. So under certain hypotheses on X, we can localize the Foucault category along X. Okay, so there exists a Cauchy on L, whose global sections are the so-called wrapped Foucault category. I'll say in a word what I'll recall in a word the definition. I think there have been talks on the wrapped Foucault category earlier this week, so I'm not going to treat it as more than a conceptual entity for this talk. So under certain hypotheses, there's a Kochief of categories on L whose global sections are the wrapped Foucault category. So this is the conjecture we want to study. And let me draw a picture.
Shiel?
Yes, question.
Can I ask a dumb question?
Huh?
The first sort of contrariety we learnt about was restriction for the
last
category.
Yes.
At which point I expected this answer to be that there should be a sheaf of categories. I mean, and I don't recall Maxine being as precise as you're suggesting.
Oh,
I don't know. What, why is this the right structure to expect?
Oh, no, no. I remember Maxine being very excited about co when he found out that it was co.
I see. Maybe not in 2000.
I think to this level he was precise. You didn't go beyond this roughly. I mean, beyond looking at some basic examples. But the reason I should think Cauchy, okay, is because you know, when I think about the sort of gluings I need to do to my homological data for Cauchy, it's of the nature of a Van Kampen theorem and not a, you know, not a Meyer-Vietor sequence. And we recall that in our first example, so actually this ties in nicely with the picture of multiplying. So in our first example, we look at a cotangent bundle with its canonical Newell form, whose spine is a zero section, and we recall that the Rapp Kukai category of this cotangent bundle is perfect modules over chains of the Basin space, right? which is some homotopical, you know, generalization of pi 1 essentially, and so this should behave the way pi 1 does. With respect to open sets on the base. So Viterbo restriction is a very different beast, right? Because I'm you know, actually restricting to subdomains, whereas I'm trying to talk about here, you know, you want to associate some category to some small open set like this. And the most natural thing you might try to think about doing is you sort of, you know, just look at everything that flows to it or something like that. And this is not of the nature of a Liouville. So I think actually there was a nice paper by James Askeleff and Nicolo Sevilla, which you know, from a couple of years ago or something, which at least in one-dimensional examples tried to explain why this Cauchy property should imply the Viterbo restriction maps. I mean, in essence, there's some wrong-way maps associated to this Cauchy. But sometimes you're a sheep with respect to wrong-way maps. Other questions about the statement so far?
So in this case, what's the quotient for Zeta?
Yeah, so what's the quotient in this case? So I'm supposed to associate to every open set on L a category. So I'll associate, I'll just tell you what it is on small open sets, and the quotient by. Okay, so here to an open set like this, you know, around a smooth point, I'll just associate sort of trivial category with one object and an identity. So that if you want, this category is local systems up to, okay, up to derived equivalents. Right, there's only one interesting local system on the interval, and so at smooth points, there's really nothing so interesting to do. Where this category becomes very interesting is at singular points. So I'll give you one example. I won't maybe go into a large variety of examples about what this Cauchy should be, but let's look at the pair of paths, which is maybe one of the next interesting Newell manifolds you might try to write down. I'll put a very symmetric Newell vector field on it and get myself a skeleton that's very symmetric looking. Of course, the skeleton isn't an invariant, it changes when I deform my vector field, but for any skeleton I should be able to do this. That's, okay, so I'll look at the skeleton, which is, if you want, a union of trivalent vertices, where all the legs are attached to all the legs, like this. And the statement is, well, I should have a quotient of categories on this spine. So to tell what the quotient is, I should just tell you what I associate to a neighborhood of a trivalent vertex and what the co-restriction maps. So okay, so I'll just superimpose the category.
Blue is invisible.
Sorry, what? Oh, blue is invisible. I should just not use blue at all. Is, let's try it for me. Okay, so I'll associate one object in this category for every, you know, know, top stratum locally. And I'll associate a morphism, you know, from here to here, to here, to here, depending on cyclic ordering of, you know, these edges. And I'll mandate that the morphisms fit into an exact triangle. Okay, so this is the fundamental exact triangle category.
Sure, since we're asking philosophical questions.
Yes.
So there is another situation where Cauchy's categories naturally appear, and that's in this non-abelian Poincaré duality factorization homology. Hmm. Is that in any way connected to this picture?
I have to remind myself of the context in which they appear there, but I mean, you might well try to study non-abelian Poincaré duality for Cauchy's of categories along the Lagrange spline. I think that's a, I would expect that that's a theory you could apply
to
a Cauchy you construct here. And this might tell you some relationships between this Cauchy and, you know, some more sheafy variant, something that, that, I mean, that would be my initial naive guess. I haven't thought about it. But, okay, so under certain hypotheses, which in particular imply that your skeleton is a singular Lagrangian spine, there should be a co-sheaf of categories whose global sections is a Raphe Kanopka category. And now, instead of going forward and telling you what I should associate with pieces of the skeleton, maybe we should try to, you know, do something more systematic symplectically. Okay, and so the idea, is, of course, if I'm interested eventually in studying the Raphe-Kanopka category of my total space, I should try to associate the pieces of my spine, symplectic pieces of my Weibull manifold, and study their Foucault categories. Okay? So the idea, of course, is that we will try to associate to a subset, a nice subset of my spine, a symplectic region, X of U, and try to take its Foucault. Okay, so this is a region in the Liouville manifold, so you have to think hard about whether a Foucault category exists or such questions. But here's one example. So here's an X and U associated to the interval. Okay. And for technical reasons, maybe I'll actually close up my interval. So I'll just look at open sets with good compactifications, and I'll think of X of U as this manifold with boundaries. So X of U will be something like T star 0, 1, T star of this closed manifold 0, 1, and this will be my first example of a Weibull sector. Okay, so in our first paper, which I'll just call GPS1, we introduced the notion of a Weibull sector and set up their Fleur theory. So sectors, which are some generalization of Weibull manifolds that have sort of extra boundaries, where, you know, here we can already see, you know, in this cotangent bundle example, the Weibull vector field points out infinity. So these Weibull sectors have these funny pieces of boundary where the Weibull vector field is tangent or something like tangent instead of outward pointing. We introduced the notion of Weibull sectors and defined. Let me just say their design. To cover Weibull manifolds and allow for local to global Fleur theoretic argument. So, without, I'm not going to yet define what Weibull sector is. I will do that in a minute. Let me just draw one other example of an interesting Weibull sector that I might associate to a piece of this this tripod point or neighborhood thereof. Okay, so here's And so it turns out that Liebel's hectares have a well-defined Fourier theory. And so I'll just recap what we understood. We could define for X a Liebel sector. We could define its rapid Foucault category. We could define closed string version of the rapid Foucault category. So we normally call this symplectic cohomology if you're a Liebel manifold. Here it turns out the the first thing you can try to write down is it actually turns out to be a rel boundary theory. Okay, so it's so this boundary didn't exist before, but here we define the symplectic cohomology rel boundary of a Liebel sector, and open closed maps, which relate these theories. Map from the Hochschild homology of the rapid category of a Liebel sector to this relative symplectic cohomology group. Importantly, we showed everything is functorial, covariantly. For embeddings of Liebel sectors, which are proper codimension zero, exact, cylindrical. Okay, so near infinity, these embeddings should look perfectly standard and cylindrical. They're exact symplectic embeddings, and there are lots of them. So for instance, I can embed this strip into sort of this thickened tripod in at least three interesting different ways. Through here, through there, and through there. And for each of those, I get functors between rapid Foucault categories, I get functors between symplectic, push forward maps and symplectic cohomology, and open closed maps, which are compatible, which are sort of morphisms compatible with functors. Okay, so, great. And it turned out this gave us a global to global method for verifying a criterion that's very popularly used in this side of Foucault categories. Abu-Zayed generation criterion. Okay, so it's about a certain open closed map hitting one in the global category. And it turned out that if we have a, what we can show almost completely directly from this setup is that if your local open closed maps are sufficiently nice and calculable, then you can deduce that open-closed hits one globally without doing any calculations. And this was nice because sometimes these local categories are sort of finite dimensional, they're smooth proper categories, whereas your global thing may not have finite dimensional Hom spaces, so you can actually calculate there. Okay, so today I want to, recall what Liebel sectors are a little bit, and then talk about something somewhat new. So I want to talk about an application of this, just categorical machinery. We actually won't use open closed maps in today's talk, but I want to talk about what we can do with Liebel sectors, and give an elementary application to what I would call stop removal. So that ties to the third item in the title. So let me tell you about that. Stop removal is a phrase termed by Zach Sylvan, I think, or Denis Arue.
Zach.
Zach, okay. In the context of partially wrapped Foucault categories. And we have an argument that's geometric, so he requires some hypotheses to remove a stop. And I'll tell you about some different hypotheses which are geometric and verifiable in a number of instances. So what is the story with stop removal? Given a pair of Liebel manifolds, um, will hide your service. In the boundary of infinity of the legal map, there is a legal sector which x bar minus the neighborhood of f. Moreover, as I'll say in a minute, all legal sectors arise in such a way. And now, so you can compare. So such a pair, it's roughly, this data of a legal hypersurface is very close. It's not the same, but it's very close to what Sylvan calls a stop. There's a contractible space of choices that make it a stop. Stop is some sort of prescription for slowing down wrapping when you're wrapping in wrap for homology. You don't cross this region, something like that. And the wrap Foucault category of X bar stopped at F just coincides with the wrap Foucault category of X. And so now you can use this perspective to compare the wrap Foucault category of X and the wrap Foucault category where I remove this stop. I no longer, well, I remove removing it, I suppose, or something like that. I mean, you know, I no longer remove it. And stop removal is about comparing these categories. So I'll state something precise in a little bit.
Can you write bigger, too?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Thanks. Is all of this okay so far? Is there anything I can?
Just getting smaller.
It's shrinking. The goal is to sort of, no, it's fine. Okay, so I'll be happy to write it. Okay. Something I won't talk about too much today, due to lack of time, is the Cauchy property, which is the next thing in progress after GPS 1.5 comes out. And we have a proof of the Cauchy property under some geometric hypotheses, which amount to having a covering by Weinstein centers instead of Weibull centers. So assuming everything inside is Weinstein, we can actually prove.
The neighborhood of F is a stabilization of F, right?
A neighborhood of F is a stabilization for some definition of stabilization.
F times the upper half plane or something.
Yeah, something like that. That's right.
And you compute the category
F times the upper half plane? That category is zero. I mean, it depends how you.
Yeah.
It depends how you define that category, but it's zero.
It does some kind of conjecture that you can create that theorem.
Yeah. Okay. So you're saying modulo Kunin issues.
No, I mean, you didn't. Did you prove Kunin theorem?
We didn't prove a general Kunin theorem, but you know, Gao has proved a general Kunin theorem, and you can either appeal to that or find cheap workarounds for multiplying by upper half planes, or anyway, I'll talk more. I'll talk a little bit. Other questions? So let's recall. Legal sector X is a legal manifold with boundary. Modeled at infinity, as before, on the symplectization of now a contact manifold with boundary. Okay. And this Weibull sector has to satisfy that's not enough. We can't just consider such an arbitrary thing like this. There's some condition we impose, which can be phrased in one of two equivalent ways. Maybe I'll just state one of them. There exists a function from the neighborhood of the boundary of X, R, which is linear to infinity. Okay. such that this function grows along the characteristic foliation of the boundary. So remember that a hypersurface in a symplectic manifold has a characteristic foliation, which is the kernel of the symplectic form. So you can ask that there exists a function which is growing in that direction. This characteristic foliation has a boundary orientation coming from boundary orientation. So you can ask it grows in positive directions. Okay, so this implies that the boundary actually symplectically splits. Into R across some lower dimensional Weibull manifold F. And this is an important aspect of this boundary. So let me draw a picture of this. So if I take the cotangent bundle of a manifold with boundary, this is naturally a Weibull sector. Here's the case of an interval, a closed interval. So here's x. Here's the boundary of x. My characteristic foliation, you can check, depending on convention, that the characteristic foliation is like this. And you can check that that implies that I has to, so I has to equal plus infinity here, minus infinity there, plus infinity there, minus infinity there. Okay, so there's some asymmetry at infinity. There's some decomposition into plus infinity, minus infinity, and neither regions at the boundary of the boundary infinity. If you want, you can also draw the Hamiltonian vector field of I. Okay, and so how do I get such a function on a manifold with boundary? I choose a metric. I choose an inward pointing vector field along the boundary of R, and I pair with that inward pointing vector field. Okay, this gives me a map from the boundary of this cotangent bundle, which is the cotangent bundle restricted to the boundary, to R. Okay, the next example is completely general, and it ties back to what we talked about here. So if I have a Weibull manifold and a Weibull hypersurface, I claim that I could get a Weibull sector by removing a neighborhood of this Weibull manifold. And how does this picture work? Let's just illustrate it for C. So if I'm C, and I fix F 3 points, okay, then I just take a bytes out of C at these 3 points. I get some new boundaries that weren't there. Okay. So all Weibull sectors arise in this way. Just note that any Weibull sector knows about the data of a hypersurface. I can just take the boundary and divide by R. So in particular, given a Weibull sector, I can recover the associated Weibull manifold. Okay, so given case, I can recover. I can recover my legal manifold X by capping off near the boundary of X. Okay, so here's just a picture. Here's X. We know that the boundary is R cross F, so I just attach like this with some vector field like this, and I recover sort of my convex vector field.
Could you draw a picture of the sort of first example that's excluded by requiring the existence of R?
Yes. So in particular, in dimension 1, the boundary of X cannot have any closed circles. Right? So the first example is this sort of compact cylinder. This is not a legal sector. Version of a partially wrapped Dwarf homology. Okay, so we can define a wrapped kind of the legal sector. Okay. Objects are Lagrangians, exact cylindrical Lagrangians in X, avoiding the boundary, so I don't allow Lagrangians to touch the boundary. And let me at least tell you the cohomology of palms in the category. So it's an A infinity category, but the cohomology of palm spaces can be described in a reasonably concise way. Okay, I just take the direct limit over all positive wrappings. By that I mean positive near infinity Lagrangian isotropies of K that avoid the boundary, which aren't allowed to touch the boundary ever. So there's a well-defined notion of positive infinity using rate flow, and so I allow wrappings which are positive with respect to that. This is often phrased as in direct limit over, you know, positive flows of a Hamiltonian, but you may as well just look at the direct limit over positive wrappings of a Lagrangian. Okay, so there's this, so we'll sometimes just call this HW of KM, the wrapped Fleur homology. And these are the cohomological morphisms in my category. And now note, this is very nearly, you know, some sort of Fleur homology. I could have just taken an X bar, right? So I can now work in X bar. This is the same, okay, for some definition of same, as a certain category I can write in X bar called the partially wrapped category X stopped. Maybe I should tell you how you change perspective and think about this partially wrapped category. Yes?
Does the definition of Liouville sector include a choice of I or just its existence? Because you said there exists and it's not obvious F is canonical.
Yeah, that's right. So if there exists an I, there exists a contractible space of such I's. So F is canonical up to contractible choice. Contractible choice of selectors. So we do write a lemma about that. Okay, so I really do know F. Now the interesting point is in the partially wrapped category stopped at something. I didn't actually need F to be a Liouville hyperspace. Okay, so I can now generalize. Here I can write something more general, where for any closed subset, R in the boundary at infinity of X, you can define the wrapped Foucault category of X bar stopped at R. Objects are Lagrangians, which are exact, cylindrical, and so on, avoiding R. And morphisms, again, I'll just tell you what the homological palms are. It's almost identical. I take the direct limit over positive wrappings in X bar now, avoiding the subset R. Okay, so I'm not allowed to cross R. I'm not allowed to even go into a small neighborhood of R if you want. So if you set things up this way, they're nearly tautologically the same definition. Okay, when R equals F. Here you can define the category for much more general R, but you don't get all the nice properties of Liouville sectors. So you don't necessarily get covariant functoriality, methods of confining disks, things you might want if you want to sort of, you know, prove you have functors, but you can certainly study these categories. Colored chalk really doesn't erase very much. What do I want with these categories? So let me just note. If F is Weinstein, so if your stop F is Weinstein with core some Lagrangian subset of F, thought of as a Legendrian subset of the boundary to infinity, then stopping at F is the same as stopping at this core. Okay, that's just more or less depends on your taste. And so we'll start to now talk about wrapped categories stopped at core. So we'll now change perspective and talk this way. Okay, so here's the first result. So this is a result in the context of partially wrapped categories stopped at R, though it encapsulates the setup earlier. Maybe I'll call it a proposition or a theorem, something in between, because the proof is relatively short. Okay, so let's... I have a point in my stop, R, such that near that point, R is Legendre. Okay, so a neighborhood intersecting R is actually a Legendrian subset. I don't know what R is elsewhere. Suppose near point R is Legendrian, and LW is obtained from L. These are two Lagrangians by positively wrapping now in X bar, not stopped at R. And I suppose that I positively wrap in X bar just once past R, and when I wrap past R, I cross P transversely. Okay, so let me draw a picture. Let me draw some pictures of this situation. So this is saying, let's suppose I wrap a little bit positively, and I cross my stop loss. Let me finish the conclusion of the result, and then I'll draw some pictures. Triangle of objects, an exact triangle of objects in this partially wrapped category. Between the positive wrapping, L, and another object called DP, which is a small linking disk. So the point is, when I wrap past the stop, I don't get the same object in my category. They're not isomorphic, but I can analyze the failure to be isomorphic. So here's a picture. Here's a reasonably, you know, general attempt at a picture in the boundary at infinity of my legal manifold. Okay, so boundary infinity of the legal manifold. Here's my stop R. Let's look at what's happening. Okay, so here's my Lagrangian, it's boundary infinity before wrapping. I want to wrap it a little bit positively. Okay, and when I do that, I cross R, but I only cross R. As I follow this line, I only cross R once at this point P, okay? And R is Legendre in this region, so there's a DP. This is a boundary infinity of DP. Okay, so at infinity, it's some sphere. One-dimensional picture where I can draw what's happening in the symplectic manifold. Okay, so here's my boundary infinity of C. Here's my legal manifold C. Let me draw L. Now R is some collection of points, and this point P is one of those points, and I wrap L a little bit past. P to L sub W. Then there's this linking disk that looks like that. So how much time do I have? When did I start, by the way?
You have about 15 minutes.
15 minutes. Many questions about the statement.
So if you assume R is of lower dimension, then do you know isomorphism?
Yeah, if R is lower dimension, then you can just ensure by some generosity argument that L just avoids P. You can further isotope things, so you just avoid it.
And you don't care about higher dimensions because you assume 1.
That's right. So Legendre is sort of the maximal dimensional case I care about, and there's something interesting happening. But you can, you know, as you cross points of R, which you can assume happen at distinct times, you can just imagine that, you know, you're getting these exact triangles in the partially wrapped category. Other questions? I can actually sketch a proof of this if there's interest, or I can first talk about corollaries. Is there a preference? A whisper of corollaries. Okay. All right, so there's this exact triangle, and let's take it for granted that it exists. The proof is really short, actually. So, but that's okay. I don't need to talk about it. It's okay.
We'd like the proof. Maybe violins in the background, for God's sake.
Do you really mean it?
They are. Just because it's you.
Ah.
Oh, I want a beer.
Alright, well, okay. I will talk about applications first, and then we'll... After all that. and then if there's time, I'll say a word. So, so here's a corollary that I'll call stop removal. And you should compare it to Sylvan's work on partially rectified categories, where a similar sort of statement is proved under different hypotheses. So let's suppose I have an isotropic subset. I start by fixing some stuff. It could be empty, and then I suppose I have an isotropic subset which, if it isn't closed, its closure lies in R. Its closure lies in R union lambda. Okay, so let's say I have such an isotropic subset. So if I add on lambda, R remains closed, then we have two cases. If this isotropic subset was subcritical, I keep forgetting dimensions, so this is a... In the dimension range less than n minus 1, then... if I start with the partially wrapped category of R union lambda and remove lambda from my stock, nothing happens. Something does happen. There's certainly still a functor to the wrapped Foucault category of X bar, but the things that are equivalent are the quotient of the wrapped Foucault category of R union lambda modulo the subcategory of linking disks. They're not necessarily trivial objects in this category, but they certainly become trivial there. So we know the functor already factors through this, and the statement is that it's an equivalence. And the proof is just immediate from this exact trial. It says that any two objects here that are equivalent here differ by some iterated exact sequences of linking disks. Okay, so. So here's another corollary, and this corollary was proved independently by Chantrain, Brazil, Higini, Belovka. And the corollary is this. Let's say X is, a Weinstein manifold or a sector. I'll just say how the argument goes for manifolds, but immediately generalize this to Weinstein sector. So remember, Weinstein manifolds are Lebesgue manifolds with a certain property on the Lebesgue vector field that implies that the Lagrangian the skeleton is Lagrangian, the spine is Lagrangian. So let's say I have a Weinstein manifold. Then the cohorts of X. So I haven't defined the cohorts of X. What I mean by this is, if you want, you just take the cotangent, all the cotangent fibers at smooth points on my skeleton. That's one way to think about what cohorts are. Otherwise, you just fix a Morse function, which is for which the Liouville vector field is gradient-like, and look at the top-dimensional ascending manifolds. Okay, so here's a sketch. So here's how we'll deduce this from stop removal. So first, use the fact that the Rapkin category of X fully faithfully embeds into the Rapkin category of X cross the cotangent bundle of an interval. This is some version of a stabilization theorem. It's a very special case of a Kunneth result. The map is easy. I just take L and I multiply it by cotangent fiber. And the point is, morphisms in here don't contribute any interesting except the rank one, because they're stopped by the boundary. So you're not wrapping around. We can think of the cotangent bundle of 0, 1 as C with two stops. At plus and minus infinity. Okay, so let's take that perspective now. So we use this fact. Now let's work. Let's just show a statement here, and we'll deduce it here. Okay. So we start with here's C. Here are my two stops. Let me get another color. Okay, so here's my arbitrary Lagrangian times fiber. What I'm going to do is I'll wrap it past the stop in the base and in the fiber. And as I do, I will cross the core of this stop, okay, which is just a copy of X, which you can instead replace with the skeleton of X some number of times. Without loss of generality, it misses everything low-dimensional and just intersects the Lagrangian parts of this core. And it does so at distinct times. And now every time it does, we apply this exact triangle. Until we've wrapped all the way past the stop, and now we're left with this object, which is L cross a cup. This is a zero object. And what did we have to do to get from L to 0? We had to take some exact triangles with linking disks, but they equal linking disks. You just check, equal cocores cross fiber. Okay. So linking disks generate this object. Therefore, cocores cross fiber generate this object. Therefore, cocores generate L by the fully faithful embedding. Okay. Any questions about the argument? So it's very short. Minute or two left?
Three or four.
Three or four. Okay. Well, I have time for the proof of this proposition. Actually, it follows a recipe very similar to something Ivan mentioned in his talk. So here's a proof sketch. Proposition theorem. And let's just work in dimension one for simplicity.
Okay.
So first, I'm going to realize the process of wrapping once past this point. As adding on a cap.
Okay.
So what's the picture? Okay, I'm just going to add on a cohortism region with something like that.
Okay.
And I notice that if I add on this cohortism, this is the same in the Foucault category. That's just wrapping. Okay, I can just straighten out the bends. Okay. Next, I use this model. Okay, so I use this model of my once wrapped L to analyze its floor homology with a test Lagrangian.
Okay.
So now we pair with a test object. Which is away from the cap and cylindrical in the shell. So here's such a test object. Let me try to get one more color. Okay, so I want to take the floor homology of this thing with maybe something that looks like that. I don't know. Okay. So here's my test object. All I meant is it really just stays away. And so I see I just take the ordinary floor homology. I'm not doing any wrapping right now. Okay. And I just immediately notice that the wrapped floor homology of K with LW, which is this thing, splits into two pieces. And there's a filtration. Okay. So we get a filtration. So for some action reasons, the differential can only go one way. We get a filtration on the floor chains of K with LW, whose associated graded pieces are the floor chains of K with L and the floor chains of K with the linking disk. If you think about, now varying your test object and suitable functoriality with respect to this by Yoneda, you get an exact triangle. That you want, L to LW to D, or whichever way I said, in the category of modules over such nice case, and in fact, even though my original observation was without wrapping, I get this exact triangle in the wrapped Foucault category by some sort of acceleration. So I get the exact triangle in something unwrapped, I push it to something wrapped, I get the exact triangle in the category of modules over nice case that avoid this region, but the category of nice case that avoid this region is quasi-equivalent to the full cap. Okay, so I'm done. So I can make any Lagrangian avoid that. Just by some isotropy avoiding the stock. I can just sort of, intersecting this cap is not something essential. You just push it somewhere else. So I'm done. Okay, thanks, I'll stop there.
Questions, comments?
Sure. Yes.
Is that also follow from the Cauchy's property, right? I mean, it's not the new
No, sure. But you might argue that the Cauchy property follows from this.
Yeah. So it's the argument that you.
Yeah. I mean, so the Cauchy property is. What does it mean to have a Cauchy? It means a certain co-limit of small categories agree with something big. how do you compute Ptolemy's? Well, first you do something that's really simple, which is you put the categories together in some way, maybe semi-orthogonally, something like that, and then you localize. Okay, so you localize by something. You identify an object and a small thing with its image and something larger. Okay, so if you can realize that localization as a stop removal, you're done. And that's very close to what
in this local example you gave for this proof, one sees a filtration by projection to C, essentially. How do you actually globally get the filtration? I mean, is it obvious that action separates these two pieces? Or does that rely on the geometry of sectors?
No, it's... let me think about what I want to say. I think it's a straightforward argument that action separates the two pieces. I mean, in higher dimensions, we're really attaching the one handle, and so things are really separated. You can argue about what values of primitives have to be.
Okay. Let's thank Shea again.
Thanks.